Hello and welcome to today's Overvolted.
That was kind of weak sauce, Kirk.
Yeah. This week's.
I know. Hello and welcome to.
You have to warn us before doing this. I'm laughing here. okay, I'll ready? Not laugh anymore. Go ahead.
Hello and welcome to Overvolted. I am your host, Kirk Johnson. And today we have Aurelian Matthew with us. Say hi.
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 We have some fun stuff to talk about today. We're going to discuss some Intel things, obviously. Well, a whole lot of Intel things, actually. And then we have some AMD information at the end. So let's go ahead and start off with a nice exclusive that we have on our website. Matthew, you want to go ahead and lead us off?
So this is a, I won't say this is a new vulnerability per se, but it's certainly doing something new, which is increasing the voltage, or decreasing it for that matter, by up to half a volt on pretty much any modern Intel CPU. We know this goes as far back as Skylake. It might go back as far as Broadwell and Haswell, though. We're not entirely sure. But it can definitely be done on, most Intel CPUs. It depends. It depends on the firmware. We'll get to that in a moment. But basically, you can increase or decrease the voltage without XTU, without BIOS settings, without anything but a simple program. And all you need are admin permissions, which we will also talk about in a little bit. And if you're familiar with overclocking, you're probably aware that half a volt is quite a bit. Increasing things by half a volt at best is going to make things very warm, because increasing the voltage directly increases power consumption. And then if you decrease the voltage by half a volt, it will immediately crash. So this can be in a program form. It's a one-time run program, and it will decrease or increase the voltage. Or you can have it in driver form so that it can persist through a reboot. Both of those require elevated or admin permissions. It works on Windows. We think it works on Linux. I believe it works on Linux. Let's see. And then also, if you want some even more voltage, you can do something called VRM overshoot, which is basically like you increase the voltage by so much in such a short period of time that a poor VRM would actually add more voltage than the target intended. So if you add like half a volt, it might add like 0.6 volts or 600 millivolts. Let's see. So basically, this is kind of like what they were doing with Pundervolt, if you remember. With Pundervolt, they were undervolting by like about 0.3 volts or 300 millivolts in order to break the SGX security module and steal info. This is kind of like that, where you are decreasing and increasing the voltage. This could also be a vector for Pundervolt. What's interesting about this vulnerability is that Intel's already patched it, basically. The Pundervolt patches should be effective against this. The only reason why this is a problem is because Intel isn't enforcing them. Their partners aren't turning them on by default. They aren't putting them into their firmware. Sometimes they're removing this, or they're adding the ability to turn this off. If you remember, a lot of like the very first 10th gen Comet Lake gaming laptops had undervolting disabled in XTU. But later, you might have seen that later released laptops were getting that feature back with an XTU. So yeah, it's a pretty bad bug, but considering that it's technically already patched, it's not that horrible. I mean, it can certainly be used for nefarious means, but as long as you have the Pundervolt patches turned on, you should be fine.
Well, Kirk, the Pundervolt, do those prevent you from doing the overvolting as well, or just the undervolt?
Yeah, both. It's both. Pundervolt totally locks you out of the voltage.
What do you think the motivation would be behind removing this patch from BIOSes? Why would manufacturers not include
That's a good question.
I don't really know, because this isn't a feature that a lot of people are asking for. I guess, are the people that want to undervolt their laptops so that they aren't furnaces, is that really that many people? I think they're just being lazy.
Well, I'm sure a lot of people would turn on Radeon Chill if they could.
Yeah, but undervolting's more tedious. Yeah. And more, it requires more technical knowledge.
Maybe it's for a stability issue or some prevent people from tinkering. It's all just speculation.
It makes it more stable if you don't let people tinker with it.
Yeah.
Also, it voids your warranty if you use XTU.
True.
So, Kirk, do you want to explain why people who think admin permission is a silver bullet and a total safeguard against hacks, do you want to explain why they're wrong?
Well, I don't know about you, but pretty much a lot of viruses, they aim to get admin level privileges. And so there's a lot of stuff out there that is very easily able to be just incorporated with this vulnerability, so that when it gains admin privileges through any kind of vulnerability that allows privilege escalation, or if perhaps this is a enterprise environment where they could have gotten the admin credentials from elsewhere, then they instantly already now have admin privileges. They can just run it with the password or with a stolen certificate or whatever in order to do things on the machine at admin level, to install rootkits or things like that, cryptoware. Those are the common uses that you see right now with those admin privileges. But this is something else that could be done now with admin privileges. Now, obviously, this requires a system that doesn't have the plunderable patches installed. And as we discussed, they aren't very widespread. They're not enabled by default in some cases. They're not even included in some cases. So it's not like you can run and get your firmware with that patch. And that's assuming businesses keep up to date with their firmware patching on their machines. And it break it to you, but not a whole lot actually do manage to stay up to date on that without having some enterprise level of management for, let's say, HP or Dell type machines. So there are quite a few machines out there that would be vulnerable. Now, what would you use this for? Well, fortunately, it's not as lucrative. So you can't make money from it. You can't cryptoware somebody's computer and make some Bitcoin or whatever. This is merely or almost solely a nefarious, destructive kind of bug. If you wanted to, let's say, do some corporate espionage, for instance, you can target a specific company and basically cause all their machines to melt, essentially.
Or if you do it the other way, you can prevent it from turning on at all.
Yeah, because there are ways to get this to persist through reboots. And I think you mentioned it was on an actual hardware level, so even reinstalling the OS wouldn't fix it.
No, it's not on a hardware level. Reinstalling the entire operating system probably would fix it, but that's a pretty extreme solution.
It's the solution that happens when people get cryptowared.
Yeah.
So now imagine pairing this with both a crypto plus this. Not only do they lose the data that's on the drive, but then they lose the hardware that the data was on.
Yeah.
So when they try to restore an image of said computer, you're now having to fight dissimilar hardware and potentially have issues restoring that image.
I mean, at the very least, it's super annoying to have to deal with.
Yeah. Almost as annoying as being ransomwared, but you know, it is what it is. But imagine having your target not have these patches in place, and then it gets spread through, say, even 50 or 5,000 computers.
Yeah.
And then all of them just detonate at the same time, and you wipe out an entire call center worth of computers. That would put a serious strain on anyone's IT department to spin all that back up. Not just because they can't just reimage these machines, but they have to procure and receive and then unbox and set up 5,000 computers. They would have to hire a lot of temps to help with that.
You could extend that logic also in the world of crypto by, for example, if you would be attacking a competitor network, and so that you could kill it, so then the effort will lower, so you could make more money before they can build it up back again. And it's a bit stretched, but
Yeah, and all of these are pretty stretched scenarios. I think if this is going to be exploited, it's going to be kind of the last thing in a chain of stuff. Like, it might ransomware the computer, or it might log and exfiltrate data for a while, and then as a remote nuke capability, it will just fry the hard drive or the CPU, because it doesn't fry the hard drive, it just fries the CPU.
Even if it can't kill the CPU, I mean, you can at least temporarily take the entire system down. And that would require at least a few... How long would you think it would... if every single computer in a company suddenly had to get their operating system reinstalled or manually repaired, how long do you think that would take to complete?
It depends on the imaging practices. Yeah, like, a lot of larger orgs will actually use imaging, and they'll be able to deploy those remotely just using like Pixie Boot to pop into a Clonezilla or whatever method they choose to do. They can re-image machines quite readily depending on how unique the machine was.
But you'll still lose the configurations and all that.
Depends on how they set up their user shares and things like that.
For example, on a corporate network, if you have your own, everybody has a machine that they're working on, their workstations and all that. So yeah. Everybody has files and whatever. Not everyone.
I mean, the data,
all the work is committed and all that. So
the data is still there.
In corporate environments, a lot of times what happens is the user profiles will be remotely mapped to a NAS share, an SMB on a Windows server, something like that, where all of that configuration, all of their personal files, all of that ends up being hosted on a server and just synced to a desktop. That way they can move around to different desktops and it doesn't affect them. There's a lot of small to mid-sized businesses where they don't do that, partly due to performance, partly due to everyone having their own individual assigned machines, and so it makes it unnecessary. So there's kind of two sides to that coin.
Oh, I came up with an interesting, very evil idea. Undervolting it, undervolting it enough so that it's stable under fairly light load or at idle, but enough so like if anything like moderately intensive comes up, so it just instantly blue screens. Like, that would probably slow down IT quite a bit.
It would start causing a lot of extra time. Yeah.
If it crashed immediately upon login, they might be quicker to go ahead and reinstall the entire operating system.
Yeah.
But if it half worked, they would probably be more focused on just repairing it.
Yeah, it only happens when you open up AutoCAD or run some kind of video processing or pull up the camera software.
They would
software.
Be looking at the wrong cause.
Yeah, they would be thinking, what is it, like a loose heat sink? Is the motherboard going out on it? Is the power supply being weird? You know, those are probably the things that would go down. That they'd have that in the back of their head of being a voltage issue, right? But they wouldn't.
No, I don't think a lot of them would think of voltage.
Well, that's the thing, is a lot of the symptoms would instantly point out where somebody who is working with hardware, they would think it's a voltage issue, which is what would lead them to power supply, motherboard, or in this case, cooling, heat sink on the CPU. And they would go and diagnose those things because they don't sit there and go, oh, maybe somebody ran an undervolting software.
Yeah. An overclocker.
They're not going to actually look at the voltage. They're not going to think about that.
Someone who overclocks, if the blue screen's death, like there's like one really common one, like clock watchdog something or other.
Mm-hmm.
That's a really common one for overclocking. That basically just means your computer isn't stable at that clock speed and voltage.
Yeah, and I would like to think myself that I'd at least run CPU-Z and look at like memory timings and make sure that the memory was set up properly and not overdone or wrong or something. But I probably would glance over the whole voltage bit unless it said 0.7.
Though Renoir idles around there.
Yeah, when it's at its base C state, it's going to say 0.7 anyway. You're just not going to see it at 0.7 when it's running at the full C state. So I would probably miss it pretty handily too.
Okay, so basically there were a lot of Intel fanboys that were like, it's not a big deal if you have admin permissions. First of all, it's really hard to get, and second of all, if you have admin permissions, you can just do anything anyways. And it's just like, do you really want to have another vulnerability? Come on.
Yeah,
and this is like
corporate environment, it is very easy to get admin privileges, unless if it's a very big company that can afford to have CSEC kind of people in the environment. You're going to have people that are just running around using admin privileges to install software, and Mimikatz can grab that like nobody's business.
Like, Intel's security is already like full of holes. Another hole still matters. A hole is a hole.
Yeah.
Oh, and I guess this leads us into our next topic.
Well, yeah, the whole idea of Spectre Meltdown was to be able to side channel attack and get things like admin passwords and stuff like that. So, recent news, the whole Spectre Meltdown, if you're not familiar with it, was using branch execution prediction to basically pull in data into the CPU and be able to figure out what that data was with some fairly exotic branch running. Basically, they could figure out anything in RAM. That's the easiest way to explain it. Meltdown was bad enough that they could do it from a browser with JavaScript. Fortunately, some of the browsers have incorporated ways to get around that so that it doesn't become a problem. Basically, they just loosened their accuracy for timing in JavaScript so that it's not as accurate and thus can't be used. Now, this is actually some research that was done that found out that we were completely wrong on the actual cause of Spectre Meltdown. Everyone's like, oh, it's branch prediction that's been causing the problem. Well, actually, it's memory dereferencing that they found that is the actual cause of the problem. They have it kind of simplified down here, where they're like, address translation attack allows unprivileged applications to fetch arbitrary kernel addresses in a cache and thus resolve virtual to physical addresses in Linux. While the original line of thought was that such attacks were related to prefetch instructions, the new finding proves otherwise, and thus the countermeasures that we currently have are inadequate. Now, instead, it exploits a Spectre BTBS AIP, branch target buffer, same address in place. How's that for an acronym for you, right? To cause information leakage, causing speculative execution and carry out meltdown and foreshadow L1 terminal faults attacks by bypassing the current mitigations. Now that's the key here, is it bypasses current mitigations. There is one mitigation, and that is specifically to target Spectre variant 2. That does correct this problem. They almost did it by accident, right? But this allows you to pull into L1 cache from L3 cache anything that you want in order to read secrets in adjacent programs, in VMs, on a host. So you could be in one VM and read memory from another. But the problem is the physical map address is dereferenced in the hypervisor kernel data and can be fetched into L1. And so basically you just prematurely dereference memory and it forces it to reload from L3 back into L1 where it can be read. So yeah.
So if they make better patches based on this new understanding, could Intel claw back more performance, or would this be even less performance?
I would think that if they now know kind of the root cause, they can fix it in hardware.
Yeah.
Now, whether that'll allow them to wipe out a lot of these other patches that severely degradate performance is another guess altogether. I mean, one of the main reasons why Spectre V2 patches aren't implemented in some orgs is because of the heavy performance loss that happens. I mean, you've seen some reports where people are like, oh, it loses up to 15%. Well, I'm not sure how much V2 specifically loses, but I believe it was in the 3-4% range, just like all the other patches would lose, 3-4% in some cases. So I can understand why some places are like, oh, we're not vulnerable. We won't install all of the patches. We'll be fine. Well, this is saying, even if you installed every single other patch, you still wouldn't be fine. You'd have to install this Spectre V2 patch as well. And fortunately, there is one other thing, Retpylene. That one does help fix this as well. And this one's also a performance degradator. not a terrible one, but it's still, it degrades the performance due to how it works.
Just to ask the naive question here for our viewers, this affects all CPUs or not?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. It's
gonna this be affects, cool. Yeah, everywhere from Intel, ARM, IBM, and AMD.
Yeah.
Because Spectre V2 is the only one of the first batch that in AMD even said they were vulnerable to. Because they're like, yeah, Meltdown, we're not vulnerable to. V1, no, we're not vulnerable to that. V2, there's some vulnerability, but, you know, we got a patch for it here, run this. And they didn't lose as much performance, hardly any at all, with their patching because they didn't require a lot of them.
And then the other naive question, while on the Linux side, you have to worry about this yourself and you have to apply them in your kernel if you're compiling your own kernel, how are these patches applied and distributed on the window for the Windows users?
Well, they're pushed out with Windows updates. With updates. And so if you remove the update that patches it, then you're in trouble.
Yeah.
With Linux, actually, when you compile the kernel, you actually have to specify without these certain patches. Like you can specify without V2.
Right. You actually have to say that don't apply this kernel.
So yeah, or else it'll do it by default, which is good security.
Yes, I agree. So even though maybe just to kind of put people at ease in a way that have your operating system updated and patched if you're using Windows, don't try to be clever when you compile the Linux kernel yourself. If you do have very specific reasons to not apply those patches, you know what you do, and hopefully you are isolated from the rest of the world. You don't do that on networks or...
Don't do it on your day-to-day machine, or if you're doing it on your day-to-day, do it on the one that's not important, so like your gaming rig, because you're trying to claw those extra FPS, right?
Or some machine that somehow is not connected to the wider internet. So some physical isolated place that, you know, you're running something in your fridge and that doesn't talk to anything else, so maybe there. But yeah.
So we can talk about the other Intel thing.
Yes. Intel made a lot of news this past week.
Yes, as usual.
It all started with their... rather frank discussion during their quarterly results, but they've just been getting beaten down the whole way from then. So go ahead and talk about this.
This is a first part of a 20, sorry, this is the first 20 gigabyte release of a big Intel leak. And there's like a lot of stuff in this. This is mostly IP stuff, so we're not terribly interested in that.
Well, and it's not like super secret either. I mean, this is stuff that they would distribute out to partners. I mean, this is the Intel Resource and Design Center, essentially. Yeah. You would go here to download firmware code, source code for a lot of the chips and some of the silicon design diagrams. I mean, there's a lot of kind of like IP related stuff in here. So yeah, it should be classified, or should I say confidential, or like restricted secret. But this isn't like the end of the world kind of stuff.
Yeah, it's significantly worse than that AMD leak from a little while ago. But it's not like it's literally everything from Intel. It's just quite a bit. There were also some other interesting stuff in here. There were some roadmaps. Some very, very rough roadmaps, I have to say. The engineering department clearly does not care what they look like. Then we also have the marketing material templates, which basically means anyone can create a fake leak now. hopefully Intel makes a new template, because we're not a huge fan of fake leaks. So overall, unless you're interested in like IP stuff and like really like technical stuff, this actually isn't that interesting.
Well, there is some technical things that people have done with this though.
Like what?
They went and obviously ran some keywords against the data to see if they could find anything important. So they ran words like backdoor, right?
Oh yeah, that.
And they found a particular bit talking about a backdoor in comments, and followed by a little bit of code that was referring to some IOH SR17. And there was a guy on Twitter, Chris Williams, who responded with some context. He's saying that I suspect the mention of the ACPI that RAS is reliability, availability, and serviceability, whereas everyone else assumed remote access server. And he says, which does memory error detection and correction. Obviously, it's ACPI, right? So IOH SR17 probably refers to Scratchpad Register and the IO hub chipset used by the firmware. So it's not this crazy backdoor where they can steal your data or anything like that. Everyone else has been running the headlines of Intel has backdoors in their firmware. And so far, that's not the case. It's just people that don't understand code or don't understand low-level code, like Chris understands this low-level stuff, obviously. Yeah. They don't understand it, so they just run with, oh, it says backdoor, and so they report on basically other people saying it's a backdoor when it's not.
Yeah, it's the behavior of the press in general to rush quickly with the headlines just to try to be first to report something potentially, but it's a high risk.
Yeah, and I probably should have put in our article that there isn't a backdoor based on what we've seen so far, but I just left it out altogether. I didn't try to sensationalize the title or the headline saying, oh, there's backdoors, because I knew there wasn't. I could see from the code that it wasn't an actual backdoor. It was just a comment in there where they called it a backdoor, but a backdoor doesn't mean that you're going to have remote access capability.
To the upon the roadmaps, there's nothing really interesting on there. I think it's only
nothing we didn't know already.
Yeah, I think it's only mobile roadmap slides. Basically, it's they don't have Tiger Lake H on there for like the gaming stuff, and it goes up to Q2 2021. So, and there was a rumor that Tiger Lake H was coming out in H1 2021. That might be wrong, but we have no idea how old these roadmaps are. There were some SKU names for the upcoming Tiger Lake CPUs. They might change it or something. It's just not that interesting.
Well, I think the only really interesting stuff to come out of this that I can see just offhand would be schematics and the silicon diagrams. So we could easily look at, you know, like X-ray of the CPU and mark out exactly where each bit of the CPU is, because the schematics would tell us. So that's the only thing I can think of, is just overlaid block diagrams for the CPUs so that you can understand what bits of the CPU do what. And, you know, that's more academic than anything.
I guess we're done with this topic.
Yeah. I guess we can go over the takeaways real quick on this. They had a lot of zips in this leak that were actually encrypted, but the password was Intel123 and I accept. So, yeah, first off, stupid passwords, easily guessable.
We should send Intel a link to our article about passwords.
Right?
Well, I read that, and apparently it's not for like, not like a password like you can log into any account you want, but like a password like, I can't remember what the...
No, these are the passwords that encrypted the zip files.
Yeah, I know, but it wasn't like a password to be like, keep it secure, but to like, it has something to do with making sure that they got it or something.
Well, it's to prevent the zip from being decompressed by scanning software for email and being virus checked.
That might be...
That's the traditional reason why you would encrypt, or should I say password protect a zip file, was just to prevent it from being opened by the mail scanner, and then, oh, look, there's an executable in here, and then drop it. And so I can understand why it was, you got to archive's a technical term, but zip these files so that you have just one file to send, right? But a lot of these you wouldn't be sending through email. Who would send restricted secret data or confidential data through email? You don't do that. This is a
really smart people would.
Well, this is a file server, essentially. You would go here, log in, and download through FTP or who knows what. You would download these files directly. You wouldn't go and have them emailed to you. So the fact that they were zipped with a password wasn't necessarily because they wanted email scanners to miss them. It was probably more so that firewall scanners would miss them. So if you're going through a firewall that does secure SSL decrypt, HTTPS decrypt, those won't pick up on the executable and try to detonate it in the cloud, that kind of stuff. And they'll allow the file through because it just can't read it. And so I can see that. And then, of course, since you're distributing it to a partner, something, it, having the words I accept be the password or Intel 123, those are forgivable as well. It's kind of hard to tell them to just do some big random character password. Although that would be the better way to do it, is on the page that you download the file, have it display a 32-character random password that they then copy and then apply to the zip file to decompress it. Those are the better things to do, because if they had done that, a 32-character alphanumeric with symbols, whatever, as the password, they'd still be trying to decrypt these by running against Hashcat in the cloud. And so they would have been a lot better off security-wise had they been secure at rest like they should have been in the first place.
Intel and security are not a great duo.
Yeah. And then, of course, the other big thing is the default settings, misconfigured cloud server. Those things are just hitting companies left and right.
I wonder what the second leak will have.
Well, it's supposed to have even more juicier bits.
If it ever comes out.
Right now, the original leaker, he's kind of laying low. He passed the data through a third party, a Switzerland-based guy who is kind of a freelance IT consultant. And so, fun stuff. All right, you want to go over this next little bit, the supply chain?
Yeah, so AMD didn't order enough Renmar APUs. I believe that's what actually happened. They're not capacity constrained, but they just didn't think it Renmar would sell this much. So yeah, this is not very surprising at all, given the extremely positive impression that people have had of AMD's new APUs. Like, there was even a, I don't know if you've heard of him, Dave Lee. He does a lot of laptop reviews. And in his Razer Blade Stealth, the new one, in his review of that, the title was Razer Blade Stealth, Cursed by Intel. Because he was like, oh, but I wish this had an AMD APU in it. The Intel stuff kind of sucks. And like the reputation is like very quickly turning. Like even in laptop reviews, whether it's like Dave Lee's or Linus Tech Tips or whatever, a lot of people are like comparing it to the like totally different laptops, like the G14, because they're like, listen, we know this is like a totally different laptop, and it doesn't compare to the 17-inch laptop with like a 2080 Max Q. But this laptop has a faster CPU, and that makes us not very happy. So, half the price. So it's selling like hotcakes. It's not terribly shocking.
Well, let's take a second to lament the fact that there isn't a 17-inch with a 2080 running a Renoir yet.
I think there's a 17-inch with a 2070. I think an XMG. The XMG one. Oh, but that's not Renoir. That's the 3950X.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Not that the laptop GPUs are that fast anyways. Like a 2080 Max Q or even a full fat 2080 is only like 50% faster than like the 2060 Max Q and the G14.
And there's a lot of people that might be wanting a desktop replacement that's kind of mobile, that runs at least Renoir. I know I wouldn't want one of the older AMD chips, as nice as they may be.
No, they're bad. They're so bad.
Yeah, they're not as bad as previous mobile chips from AMD. They're doing well, but they're still only 4-core, 8-thread kind of stuff.
They were barely passable.
Yeah,
I'd say they're barely passable.
Barely passable. I wouldn't consider one of their desktop APUs unless if it had more than 4 cores as well. So this is the first that actually provides better. And the Vega graphics in these are actually not that bad. Compared to Intel, they're phenomenal.
And then there's also, this is kind of on a similar tangent, Hardware Unboxed did a review of a laptop that actually has, it's pretty much the same exact laptop, but one is Intel and one is AMD, which is really cool for like comparing apples to apples, finally. because when Renoir first came out, we only had the G14 as a reference. And then we had stuff like the A15 and the G15, but they were all like fairly like unique laptops. Now we finally have almost the same exact laptop. The interesting thing about this laptop from XMG, again, this is a 15-inch laptop, they are specifically tweaked for each CPU. So if you'll notice, you can see that the AMD laptop on the left, Intel laptop on the right, they have different heat sinks, and some of the stuff is arranged a little differently. Stuff like the I/O, the M.2 slots, the Wi-Fi card, that kind of stuff, that isn't different. But where the heat pipes are, how many heat pipes you have, and where the RAM is, that is all different. So AMD actually gets less CPU cooling compared to the Intel laptop. But in exchange, it gets a lot more GPU cooling. It's 10% higher power budget for the GPU. While on the Intel side, they had to do a lot more CPU cooling because the CPU is a lot hotter. So it's very interesting that they designed two heat sinks and boards specifically for AMD and Intel. You would have thought that it would have been like perhaps handicapped for one model or the other.
Yeah.
And then if we just scroll to the performance summary, it looks not great for Intel. It's 20% faster on average, but some of these wins are like really high. Like there's like a 55% win in Blender, 7-zip decompression, that's 54, handbrake's almost 50%. Adobe is like a pretty nice win for AMD on the whole, about 10-15%. And then you have like a Chromium compile, which is like almost 17%.
I mean, and getting that close in Photoshop, Intel has traditionally been kind of ahead in Photoshop benchmarks.
I think this is actually six-core Intel CPU.
Yep.
Yeah. But the thing is, they have the same power budget. Well, actually, Intel has a slightly higher power budget. You can't be like, oh, that's unfair. It's fair because it's almost the same exact laptop. If you put an 8-core Intel CPU in here...
What's the price difference between these two laptops?
I think it's about $500.
The Intel one is around $100 more.
Is it? I might be...
Yeah. That's $14.50 and $15.
You end up with a...
That's in pounds, though. So.
Yeah, so you end up with a laptop with a stronger CPU that uses less power than the Intel equivalent laptop, and it's cheaper.
Yeah,
and has the exact same GPU.
The only reason why you would end up getting the Intel one would end up being if your workload has some severe kneecap on AMD hardware, which so far we haven't seen any of these workloads that get kneecapped too much.
Or if you need to
Adobe Acrobat PDF.
I want to see.
Or
okay,
if you need to run a lot of single threaded loads.
Yeah, the only actual two workloads on here that are bad for AMD are Puget's Photoshop benchmark and Adobe Acrobat. And AMD loses the Photoshop benchmark by 3% and the Acrobat by 11%. So it's like, okay.
Of course, if you're doing your 3D modeling and stuff in single thread, then you got to worry as well.
Yeah. Yeah, but like at most by like 10% according to Cinebench R15.
Yeah, and that's R15.
Yeah, that's a little bit older. In Cinebench R20, it's only 4%.
Yeah, and those are very minute losses compared to 50 to 60% gains.
And it's still more efficient. Even though it's losing, it is still more efficient.
Yeah. It loses with style.
You can see in the battery life benchmark that I don't know which workload this is. This is encoding on Handbrake. The Intel laptop on its battery could not even finish it before it died. Well, AMD finished it not only faster, but also with 38% of its battery remaining.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, yeah, I mean, you could do work on the go if you really needed to. I mean, obviously you shouldn't, but I mean, it's just clear that the power efficiency advantage and the performance advantage is pretty much entirely within AMD's favor.
But what's laudable here is the effort that the XGM, well, what's the name of the company?
XMG,
that they went through to optimize both platforms. Because like you mentioned in the beginning, so this is not just a sloppy put together laptop. Yeah. It seems that they really paid attention for each platform to squeeze the most juice out of what they could from the respective setups. So it's not like the company did a sloppy job to implement an Intel solution or something. They have really looked at it and they have tried to, like the heat pipes, like you said, and everything. Yeah. So the designs are different and the layout on the board is a bit different and all that. So it's I think the single most, well, the best example I've seen so far that you can compare one-to-one, Intel versus AMD laptops, especially the screen is the same, the GPU is the same, memory is the same. What else was there?
Pretty much everything's the same except for the heatsink and a little bit of the motherboard design, but that they're only moving stuff around. And what's really interesting, now there weren't any gaming benchmarks in this, but they gave...
That comes in part two. They said they will be in the video. Yeah.
But because the AMD CPU runs at a much lower power level and is more efficient, they actually gave the GPU on the AMD laptop more power to work with. So it's going to be faster in games, basically. Not by a lot, but it will be faster. I don't know what...
A couple watts kind of thing, yeah.
No, it's like 10 watts. It's a 10% boost. I don't know what GPU this is. Okay, so it's a 2060. At 100 watts, the 2060 isn't super constrained, but an extra 10 watts is going to make... That'll probably scale fairly linearly. So the AMD laptop's probably going to be 10% faster overall. Like, I'd expect that even in Far Cry 5, which is going to be fairly GPU-bound with this kind of GPU.
So I would really like to have a look over in a few months how these models are selling, especially, and try to see to compare, but more if the consumers really start looking at the, if they are still brand loyal, no matter what, or they really start looking what they are buying.
I don't think Intel has the mind share that like Nvidia does. Like, it's just like people are like sick of the Intel laptops.
I'm more thinking about the grandma who buys a...
Oh yeah, that this, I mean, like person. I don't think they care if they're buying Intel or AMD. It's gonna be whatever's cheapest.
Yeah,
and that'll be AMD.
Mm. So be sure to check out this video on Hardware Unboxed and check out their follow up as well, where it'll have gaming benchmarks. So
also, I want to say Tim's mustache looks great. Tim is challenging Steve with his facial hair.
I did not even notice until you mentioned it.
Yeah, it's a good mustache, I have to say. I wish I could grow a mustache like that.
You wish you could grow facial hair? Is that what I'm hearing?
I do have facial hair, but it's very short.
And patchy?
Not patchy, but it's just short. Like, it's not like, I don't know. Like, if I cut it, it'll grow really fast at first, and then it just stops. Like a centimeter.
It starts curling.
No, it doesn't even curl. It's just like it's just there. It's just like it's as if it's just decided, like, I'm gonna stop growing right here.
Yeah,
it's good for me.
Well, since I kind of had a side freelance gig as a firefighter, then I actually have to have my face shaved so I can wear a respirator.
That's a good excuse, Kirk.
It is also a safety thing to have short hair. Doesn't hair catch fire quite fast?
Well, it's a respirator thing. In order to get a proper seal on a respirator, or should I say an SCBA, if I'm being technical, it's like a scuba gear, but instead of being underwater, it's just SCBA. So it's self-contained breathing apparatus.
Do we want to move on to questions?
Yeah, let's go.
So our first question is from Curry Gohan and Kamahamaha. Is the current TSMC 7-nanometer node supply constraint as a result of the node being that much better than everyone else's, a lack of 7-nanometer capacity at our fabs, or much greater demand for 7-nanometer than for other leading edge nodes in the past? What makes 7 nanometer so special? I guess it'd probably be all of those.
Yeah, it's definitely a lot of that combined. I mean, everyone's been stepping up their orders for 7 nanometer. Yeah. Like AMD, for instance, has been increasing their orders. But there's a lot of other companies that are wanting to get on 7 nanometer from TSMC because the competing things like Samsung, 8 nanometer and stuff, are having such yield issues.
Yeah. Well, no, actually, I don't think 8 nanometer is having the yield issues. It's 7 nanometer.
Is it their 7? Okay.
Yeah. But I mean, that's when they introduced EUV, and they went very hard on EUV. Really?
It's also the fact that the 10 nanometer from Intel is in shambles. So there's no equivalent competitor on the same. Because weren't the expectations that the 10 nanometer would be equivalent in terms of efficiency to
TSMC? Well, Intel isn't necessarily a direct competitor to TSMC. Yeah, they're both foundry leaders. But it's more, Intel focuses more on TSMC because their competitors use TSMC. TSMC doesn't necessarily see Intel as a big threat. The thing, it's more about like how Samsung hasn't been producing great nodes recently. Global Foundries is out of the race. A lot of other older fabs have dropped out. There's also the fact that the 7 nanometer node ramped up really quickly. Like they got things online a lot quicker. If you compare it to 16 nanometer, that was a quick ramp. 7 nanometer was even faster. 28 nanometers was molasses slow. Like, it took years for it to get up to its, like, maximum capacity. Yeah. And I'm not sure exactly why that was. I'm not sure if that was down to demand or, like, manufacturing issues. But they have certainly had no problems getting 7 nanometer online. Yeah. And It's not a cheap node. 7 nanometer is not cheap, but I think it's just like it's really good. It's not in great supply right now, but like it yields well at least. It's a safe bet. And who else are you gonna go to, right?
Pretty much. Mm. Even Intel is going to them.
Yeah, well, probably not for their CPUs.
No.
Okay, so
next
question. Yeah, okay. From Nick, what's the worst trending thing that tech corporations try to push? I've had to think about this one for a little bit.
It has to be trending.
I don't think this is trending anymore, but the notch, God, that was the worst.
I mean the phone trend. On the phone.
Yes, that was the worst thing that ever happened to phones.
It is a bad idea. I also don't like it.
It's so ugly.
It's usefulness.
And they only did it because Apple did it. Because Apple wanted to chase a figure that doesn't matter.
I would also say in that same, if we think about phones, I would say also the curved. I don't mean the folding screens too, although that's not yet trending, but the curved screen. The screen that curves at the edges.
You're talking the beveled edge?
Like the beveled, yeah, sorry. Yeah, the beveled edges. I don't like it. The thing is that I have a phone that has those edges, and because it somehow gets false inputs from as I hold the phone on the sides.
They have the touchscreen activate there as well. That's bad design. Yeah,
well, they intended on it so that you can get edge peaks, that you could like have the edge of the phone have its own information bar.
Right.
Kind of thing, and you can interact with the edge of the screen as opposed to the front of the screen. I mean,
it's a bit annoying.
Anyone who's held their phone would know that that was a bad idea.
Mm.
Because your fingers wrap around the edges so that you can hold onto the phone better. But no, they wanted to make a phone that's super slick and has glass as its surface, and so it just slides right out of your hand, necessitating
a case. You're holding it wrong.
I know I'm holding it wrong, just like everyone holds their Intel or their Apple phone wrong.
Their Intel phone. I hope no one's holding it.
If they're holding an Intel phone, they're definitely holding it wrong. They're hodling. That's what it's.
Yeah. But other things, other than like phone stuff, that was really the only thing I can think of. Like pushing stuff. Always online, maybe.
Dropping the SD card.
Yeah, like cutting out. Honestly, The cutting out IO thing hasn't been a big deal for a while. That's only really a thing on thin and lights. Like, I'm happy with the IO I get on my G14. I get HDMI, I get two USB Type-C. That one of those has a charging headphone jack, two USB Type-A's. I'm pretty okay with that.
PC World has been fine with not removing too many of the USB ports and things like that. And Apple has been terrible with removing IO. I'm talking about phones as well for this.
Removing the headphone jack.
No, the headphone jack is fine. I don't know many people that don't use Bluetooth anymore, but I know at least on airplanes, having that headphone jack becomes very useful, because if you're taking a 6-hour flight, your headphones are going to need to be recharged or whatnot, or they might not allow you to use Bluetooth at all.
I don't know if this is a trend per se, but I hate that electronics manufacturers are not using USB Type-C. They are still using Micro-B, and that is infuriating, because Micro-B is horrible.
But I would say that changed, at least over here in Europe.
No,
really?
A lot of stuff, especially headphones, still use Micro-B. My Corsair Void headphones,
charging?
Yeah, for charging. Like this cheap pair of headphones I bought with like Bluetooth and a headphone, like a 3.5 millimeter cable, that still uses Micro-B. A lot of stuff still uses Micro-B, and it's very annoying. My mouse is Micro-B.
Maybe we are luckier between the EU, because there has been this directive some years back, 5 years back or so. I don't remember the politics, but there has been this directive that they were trying to limit the amount of accessories that you need to get when you buy a gizmo. So one of them was the charging, standardizing the chargers and the data. So USB-C slots very nicely in that. So it kind of became very, very popular in various devices that you're buying, over phones or what else you get, tablets and whatnot.
So that they're making initiatives to block the number of dongles. Did they just ban Apple altogether over there?
No. The initiative wasn't, I mean, that was the end goal, but the initiative was that they wanted to standardize them, so you don't have to always buy a new charger when you buy a new phone or a new tablet. So you could use any charger there, as long as it obeys to the electrical specification when it comes to voltages and amperes and all that. But just because of the form factor, you don't have another pin format that you have to just buy another piece of cable that you are throwing after 5 years in a big pile of e-waste.
I'm actually going to defend Apple a little bit on the dongle thing. To be fair, they do pretty much always use USB Type-C and Thunderbolt 3, which is pretty good.
You mean like the Lightning port?
No, well, minus the Lightning. But that's phones only. They need to use USB Type-C on the phones. That's the only place. But I'm talking about like more like the MacBooks and like the iMac and the Mac Pro. Like, it looks pretty decent. I've never used a Mac. Well, I've typed on one like once. But if I had like a Mac product and it had like a bunch of Thunderbolt 3 USB Type-C ports and that was it, I probably wouldn't hate it that much.
You just that have to have a few dongles.
You only need one. I have a dongle.
Hey, as long as you bought other Apple products to go with that laptop, you wouldn't need the dongles, because it would have that Lightning port already.
Yeah.
It's all in the family. All right, you got another question?
Let's see. With the fall of Intel, are we going to switch from RGB to RG lighting, or will it be RGD? RGT with ARM's teal, or RISC-V's deep blue?
Don't worry, everyone already has that blue light filter, so it doesn't matter.
Well, if you don't have an Intel CPU, you don't get the blue. Everyone knows that. My LEDs are only red because I am AMD and AMD.
Well, joke aside, I also tried. I keep my LEDs mostly red because I have a AMD only system.
Oh god!
I know. I'm weird that way. Yeah.
Yeah, I got the Nvidia in mine, so mine's RG for sure. But I do have a work laptop with Intel, and so I do have full RGB coloring here, so I can make pictures for you guys with full spectrum.
I think this question was meant more of a joke.
Yeah.
Oh, that's why we're treating it.
It's from But it's from Carbon Cry, who never actually asks serious questions.
He doesn't need to. He's smart enough. He knows all the answers.
Yep. Okay. And then we have a final one. There has been a report by BBC about U.S. Secretary of State Mike Pompeo says he wants a clean internet. What he means by that, he wants to remove Chinese influence and Chinese companies from the internet in the U.S. What are your thoughts on this? Wouldn't it be possible that the U.S. would also follow in China's footsteps?
His idea of a clean internet is removing China from it, not porn?
I don't think, well, if they would, if Mr. Pompeo would want to do that, he would kind of have to do the whole China thing, the thing that, like, China does.
The but great firewall China, of China yeah. is already isolating them from the internet.
Yeah, and also, it doesn't really work that well, to be honest. Because Chinese people are, like, they mostly keep themselves willfully ignorant if they are ignorant. It's not that they're coddled by the Great Firewall. It's just that they're raised to really like the government. As far as I can tell. I'm not an expert.
I would just say that Mike Pompeo doesn't really understand what the internet
is. Yeah, so. Most government people don't because they're really old.
I mean, he might want to do that, but there are so many reasons why the U.S. shouldn't do it, including the fact that this is one other, probably nowadays, the most important vector of U.S. influence in the world, the internet. So why would you chop one more leg that you guys have? You have already been managed to chopping so many already, so why would you chop yet another one? So,
well, it doesn't quite work like that, where you can't just go and cut the undersea cable and say, oh, China's no longer on the internet. Just doesn't work like, that way.
I imagine
Mike with these huge pliers, you know, going there next to these houses next to the beach and just cutting the fiber cable. There.
No more internet for you, China.
All that pirated cable. I mean, if they haven't cut off North Korea, then they're not going to cut off China.
Kim Jong-un plays Steam. That's confirmed.
See, there you go.
Yeah.
Really?
This actually might not be true, but this is a fairly old meme. Like, someone posted, like, a map of, like, the Steam, like, you know, like a global map of where Steam users are. And there was one tiny little green dot in Pyongyang. And now it might not be Kim Jong-un, but somebody there has Steam.
So now CIA has it, or actually it's not CIA. Who has the nuclear deterrent? Who controls that? Those rockets over your place? What the agency? Who controls the, is it the air? I don't know. Those guys
who set the targets. Missile Command.
That's the name of that. So now they put a crosshair on that position, so in case it happens, one will go there.
Well, we know where Pyongyang is.
Yeah, it's not like
that doesn't mean Kim is staying in Pyongyang.
No, he has his beach house over on the eastern coast.
So he has a villa somewhere that...
It's where he hid from human malware.
Yeah, but this time I don't think you...
Oh, Kirk, you said it. I just realized.
I don't think that...
Yep, we got to be consistent here.
You'll have to keep it now. Put a nice picture over your words now.
Just stretch out when you said human malware to make it seem like it was like all one phrase.
Human malware.
If you've done that, then good job. If not, then you disappoint me.
No, human malware.
Okay. So that's our last question, I guess.
Thanks for playing.
Yeah. Thank you for questions. And that was from Tara. I always forget to say who says what.
We can mention a slight correction or clarification from last time, where we were talking about Intel being able to readily fire contractors versus employees. The United States has at-will employment for 49 out of its 50 states, Montana being the exception. And so that gives employers the right to fire anyone at any time for any or no reason whatsoever. And it's kind of a common thing across the globe, actually. The only thing is there might be some people confusing that with right to work. And that is something that controls whether employers can hire somebody but mandate that they be part of a union. And so that tends to get confused a little bit when you're talking at-will employment versus right to work. So just thought I'd clarify that a little bit. You can get wrongfully terminated in the United States for certain things, like if there's an implied contract. That's probably the most common one, where the employer's like in writing even that, oh, if we're looking at potentially terminating you, what we'll do first is go through these series of corrective measures, put you on kind of a probation or something like that to try to see if you'll come around to being a better employee for us before we go ahead and just terminate you. And that would be an implied contract, and especially if they have it in writing, that'll definitely be in your favor. Unless if they put also in writing that this should not be construed as a contract. So,
but it is true that it's much easier to terminate the contract with the company than to to just fire someone.
You can overnight just terminate a contract with a company saying, you know, for whatever reason, we don't want you here anymore. Give us a different person, that kind of stuff. And they have to give you a different person. It's you're paying them to give you labor, not a particular employee. So that's what I was getting at, was it's a lot easier to just say, give us somebody else, than it is to just fire somebody that you're already paying payroll taxes and stuff on and invested in.
Kirk, you're fired.
Exactly. All right. Pack it up.
All right. Thanks for watching the podcast. We'll see you next time.
Yeah. And hit the like, subscribe, ring the bell, all the usual stuff. Leave comments, upvote, downvote, I don't care. Just give us some feedback.
Delete our channel.
They can't delete our channel, but they can unsubscribe from it if they really felt like it.
And thank you, Patreons, for helping us here.
If we get 10,000 subscribers the next day, we'll delete our channel.
Yeah, I don't think Adore wants to be held to that. Now, go ahead and leave us some questions as well if you want to be mentioned at the end of our podcast or in our Q&A. And I guess that's it. We'll see you next time.